welcome everyone who's joined us already for our very first webinar. We're just going to take a first few moments to allow some more people to jump on. We're just bang on 7:30 now, so I'll just let people get time to sign up and sign on. In the meantime though, if you want to use the chat section on the right, you can introduce yourself, maybe write down what products you have. And then just, we have a poll as well. So on the right-hand side, there's a question you can answer for us while we're waiting for everyone to join. Thanks, guys. It's great to be getting some answers in that chat. Being the webinar forum, it is hard on our end to have that connection with you guys. So we want to make sure that you're welcome to talk in that chat section. It is a casual webinar, so feel free to pop in thoughts, ideas throughout the webinar. It's good to see we have a bit of a variety here. So we have some people brand new to hydroponics and some people are old users with lots of our products, which is great. So I think this webinar will be helpful for everyone. We'll be introducing you to hydroponics, but those people that feel like they know a lot, you'll still be able to get some good takeaways from this webinar. I'm confident about that. Okay, so those numbers have steadied off now for people joining, so we might get going and people pop in throughout, that's fine. To start off with, I'll just introduce myself. So my name is Katlin Tilley and I'm the project assistant here at Urban Plant Growers. And Dilhan, would you like to introduce yourself?
Hey everyone, I'm Dilhan. I co-founded this company with Peter Cole about 3 years ago, probably about 34 months ago at the moment, if we're being specific. And I'm really glad you've all joined us and I'm really excited to see all the questions you're asking and seeing the variety of people that are in here. We've got some people with eco kitchens or regular smart gardens, and then just some people who want to get started and might value some of the feedback or points that we have on the growth mediums and nutrients. So it's going to be a really awesome opportunity to help you all out as much as we can and kind of explain things in a bit more depth than what we normally do.
Great, thanks Dilhan. So just before we begin, I just want to do a little bit of housekeeping for everyone. So we have our chat section on the right that I mentioned before. Feel free to keep popping in all your thoughts and ideas through there. It's great to see how many people are engaging already. I mentioned that poll section that we have. So throughout the webinar, we're going to be asking a couple questions. Sorry, I just heard my volume is a little bit low. Is that any better now? I'll just try and speak up a little bit. Okay, so I'm going to keep going. Hopefully you can all hear me. Thanks, Claire. So as well as that, we're going to have a question and answer section at the end. So pop in your questions as we go and we'll reach them at the end. Thanks, guys. Now I'm going to continue with the presentation. Before we begin, I would like to do a welcome to country. So our warehouse is situated in Sydney. So that's where I'll base our welcome to country off. We would like to acknowledge the Gadigal of the Eora Nation, the traditional custodians of this land, and pay respects to the elders, both past, present, and emerging. So what will today consist of? Well, we're very excited about today being our very first webinar. So we're going to start it off with a welcome to Urban Plant Growers. And then we're going to go into a little bit about why Urban Plant Growers started, and then that leads us into the food system. So I'm going to be explaining a little bit about the problems of the current food system And then Dilhan is going to go deep into an introduction to hydroponics. He knows everything behind these systems that we have. So he's our guru tonight to tell us everything about our systems. And then towards the end, we're going to have a question and answer that I mentioned before. So pop your questions in as we're going, and then we'll try and get to as many as we can. Great. So why do we start doing these webinars? The purpose of this is so we want you guys to feel as though we're all a community here. We're not just a retail brand that's sitting behind the online store. We want to make sure that each of our products that is sold to you feels as though it's usable, you're able to keep it for a long time and keep it growing. We are also very aware that hydroponics is new to a lot of people. So for that reason, we want to make sure that you understand these systems and can get the best use out of them. So our webinars are one of the ways that we're trying to really work closely with our community base to try and make sure you guys know how to use your systems in the best way. So we want to provide a network. We want to use this space to answer questions, and everyone can learn some new skills, which is great. In addition to our webinars, we also have our unique Urban Plant Growers Community Facebook page. So beyond this webinar, we want you guys to be able to use this Facebook page to try and put in any questions that you might have, upload videos or photos of your systems. We'll respond to you as much as we can, but I think there's a lot of knowledge within the community base as well. So if you know the answer to the question yourself, jump on that Facebook page and engage with other urban plant growers and see what everyone's doing with their products. There is a little QR code on this slide. So if you are on your laptop, you might be able to grab your phone out now and scan that, and it'll send you to a link where you should be able to find our page. Otherwise, on Facebook, if you go on to Urban Plant Growers Community, if you search that, you'll be able to find us. So I'm going to pass over to Dilhan as our co-founder, and he will explain a little bit more about the background.
Thanks, Katlin. So just to give you all a bit of a background on Urban Plant Growers and how we started, I think Peter and I, the co-founders, we both came from slightly different angles. I was very techie and I was trying to develop something in my backyard to get a better understanding of how hydroponics worked and how we could productize this into something that everyone could use. And on the other hand, Peter was a lot more business savvy. And he had a much better idea of, you know, how we could actually start it, how we could start up an e-commerce company, and how we could start selling to people and actually reaching customers. When we first started, there weren't much alternatives in the market. There's an American company called Click and Grow, and they basically charged about $200 plus postage and 2 weeks postage, because it's coming from the States, for a product which is similar in size to our indoor smart garden. And we saw this as a big problem in the market, something that was preventing Australian people from being able to grow food hydroponically at home. So we did some research and we found out alternatives. And over time, we've sort of tweaked our business enough that we can actually reach a lot of people. And we have reached, you know, that thousands of you really, and kind of started to educate people on how hydroponics actually works. And it's absolutely amazing from Peter and my perspective, because when we first started this, we would speak to so many people who had no idea what hydroponics was and how it worked. Whereas you speak to people now and there's just a much better awareness of the general technical side of hydroponics, what it is, what the benefits are. You know, since we initially started, we have done a lot of growth. So we've scaled into our own warehouse. We've made a couple of things central to our business, which are quick customer service, good quality customer service, fast dispatchment of the products themselves. And of course, we've worked as hard as we can to make the user experience of using our products as clean and neat as possible. So yeah, I hope we can keep continuing on that way. Our goal moving forward is to be incredibly customer centric. So continue to work on those things. And continue to find products that you couldn't typically find anywhere else on the internet. Yeah, and in addition to this, I'd just like to make a quick note, like we do have a very startup culture. We're quite a small company, so we do things slightly different, and I hope that some of you have experienced that within some of the products that you've tried out. distilling all of this, it kind of brings us to our main mission, which is to make it easy for everyday people to grow their own food. And by everyone, we do mean everyone. So our products, you know, like when we first came up with the company, we thought a lot of people in apartments would like this because they don't have natural sunlight, they don't necessarily have a garden. But what we came to realize was we ended up reaching a lot more people. So people who live in rural areas and may not have much access to large amounts of water, or people who just were not 100% good at growing plants, should I say. And it kind of became something that you could provide to anyone, and anyone would realize that they had the capability within themselves to quite easily grow plants right in their kitchen. So I'll just pass over to Katlin, who will talk about the problems that we're trying to solve and give you a bit of insight on that.
Great, thanks, Dilhan. So this section is really my strength and my background and why I first got involved with urban plant growers. I love that they're trying to tackle these issues that we're facing in our current food system. So I might focus a fair bit on food production in our food system throughout this, but remember that it's all linked with all plants. So if you're not into growing your food as such, still remember this is important to look at these problems as not just food, but how we're incorporating our lives with plants in our day-to-day life. So stay tuned whether these food, whether you're growing food in your systems or not. So we see the problem in four main areas. So our current food system and our urban environments have problems in our environmental, economic, health, and time. I'm going to dive a little bit deeper into each of these for you. So environmental, at the moment, the average distance our food travels is 1,618 kilometers just to get to us, and that's on average. A lot of our food, unfortunately, is actually being flown in from overseas. For a country like Australia, we're very food secure. We grow a lot of food, but we have this demand to want to be able to have all of our fruit and vegetables all year round, which means some things that we can't necessarily grow here in Australia end up on planes getting flown to us, which means that there's a huge carbon impact from the food that we're consuming. Next to that is a huge food waste issue. So on average around the world, about a third of all of our food that we have is being wasted. So this means that everyone in the world should actually be able to have enough food. It's just not distributed properly, and a lot of it is wasted. And unfortunately, this is just people like you and I. You have your scraps that you don't end up finishing, the food that's in the back of the fridge that you don't end up getting to. And this is not only costing the environment, but it's costing us as well. So this is a really big passion of mine, is controlling the level of food waste that we have. And it's actually been estimated that here in Australia, we waste about 300 kilos per year. That's just a massive amount of food that we don't need to produce, transport, and then end up wasting. And the third one is the plastic issue that goes along with our food packaging when we purchase it from our large grocery stores. This photo on the right here was actually taken by one of our customers, and they tagged us in it. They must be growing some excellent basil from home and won't be needing to go to Woolies for their basil anymore, which is great. But it shows the plastic packaging that is incorporated with Woolworths and Coles and a lot of other grocery stores. So there is that environmental impact from your transport, from your food waste, and then the plastic packaging that's really getting centered around our food system at the moment. I'm just going to take a pause from speaking at the moment and show you a little video. It's only short, about a minute long, but I think it really grabs together the way of what's going on with our food waste. So stay tuned for this one. first. Okay. Right, so I know that's only a very simple and almost a little bit childish video, but I think it gets those emotions stirring and it makes us realize the journey that our food takes to get to our homes. And yes, I know, I see the comments. Everyone's really sad for the strawberries. How smart to use that. The music and everything really stirs up the emotions. But yeah, so basically, the reason that I showed this is because it's important for us to become aware of how important it is to not waste our food. But I'm a big believer that once you grow food, you're a lot less likely to waste it. You've seen it growing and flourishing. You've put the time and effort into it. So that's your little baby. So you're not going to end up wasting it. So this is another reason why I love giving people the opportunity to grow their own food. The next one is the economic. So when we are, for example, importing food from overseas, we're not supporting our local farmers. So we often end up supporting big corporations, which have a lot of middlemen, and the money doesn't end up trickling down to our farmers. So a great alternative to that can be supporting local farmers, or it can also be growing your own food. So that also ends up keeping more money in your own pocket. You become a bit more empowered as well about growing your own food, and you get really savvy with it. It might seem like a big investment at the start, but over time you will see how much money you are saving yourself, which is so great to see. The next impact is health. So that image you see on the left is very common in our grocery stores right now. When I see that, I see a lot of packaged foods. I don't see fruits and vegetables. And yes, we might have a section of fruits and vegetables, but that's all at one end. All the middle rows are taken up by packaged processed food. And this is leading to a lot of health issues around the globe. We're getting away from seeing food that we recognize. If it's in a packet being highly processed, you might not know what is actually in it, and it might not have the nutritional benefits that you need to be able to grow and be healthy and keep your immune system up. So we're seeing throughout the world a large increase in health issues and obesity and a huge reliance on medication. So I'm a very strong believer that if we come back to our roots, remember what our food is, start growing our food and eating real food that we recognize, fruits and vegetables and meats, whatever it is, food that you know what it is, that is fueling your body, will help reduce those health impacts. And finally, time. We feel as though we're so busy in our day-to-day life, but when you get those moments to slow down, you realize that you have more time than you understood. Or if you give yourself the time to really relax and unwind, and that's where I use my little plant baby. So I use my plants as a time to really relax. Instead of coming home and sitting in front of the TV where your mind's still very stimulated, the plant world is very meditative and it's really helpful for people to relax, reduce their stress and unwind. So instead of having that photo on the right where we all feel as though we're running around looking really crazy and busy and hectic, it's nice to be able to take some time to realize what's important for us in life and really appreciate the world we have around us and beautiful plants. So after that little bit of a recap of the problems that we see within our food system, if you'd like to just go to the poll to the right, if you could talk about what issues you care about most, it's really interesting for us to be able to see what our customers are really engaging with. And then we can help design our products or our future webinars around this. So I'll give you a moment to answer that. Okay, so I was kind of alluding to this throughout that previous section about the problems, is that hydroponics can be a great solution to these issues. So So there are many reasons why, and it's not just hydroponics, but it's generally growing plants in urban areas, but more local food as well. So let's just dive into that deeper. So this slide shows the very specific benefits of hydroponics. And it's pretty amazing when you start to look at it, that you're not just growing plants, you're growing plants incredibly efficiently. And you're able to grow plants anywhere in the world in any kind of environment. So that removes the excuses that we used to have. Oh, I can't do it now, I'm in a unit, or my house is too small. The incredible part about urban plant growers, it empowers anyone to be able to grow plants anywhere, anytime. So growing hydroponically uses 90% less water than traditional farming. And this is because the water is held in the basin and it's not exposed to evaporation from the sun. While we do have our grow lights, it's protected in that layer of the covering. And that water is used very efficiently. So it's not going to be spread out through other plants. It's only directly applied to our plants. And this, in combined with other factors, leads to the fact that we have faster growth rates, from 30 to 50% faster. This is because we're creating the ideal situation for our plants. They're spoiled little plants, our hydroponic plants. They have perfect sunlight. They have perfect nutrients. They're not fighting for nutrients between other plants. So they're very lucky, which means that they don't get restricted by, outside environmental factors and climate. So they're able to grow a lot faster. Like I mentioned before, our food on average travels over 1,000 kilometers to get to us. So by being able to grow your own food, you're actually saving your food miles by 95%. I know some people have already messaged in with a few questions around pests, but in general, our hydroponic systems do have fewer issues with pests, which is great. We'll go into more detail though in question and answer to try and support you guys if you are having issue with pests. I mentioned this before, but because you control your water and the sunlight, you're not as influenced by the climate. So that might mean that if you are in a city and the outdoor temperatures are very variable throughout the day, you might get a lot of rain, sometimes not a lot of rain, or you might not get a lot of sunlight, you're still able to grow your plants. Even, not so much applicable to Australia, but we are coming into winter, so we're reducing our daily sunlight. As well as that, people overseas in Canada, hydroponics is becoming very popular as they're able to grow their fruit and veg all year round, even when it's a blizzard outside, which is great. The next factor is soil-free farming. So often we don't have access to high-quality soil, which would enable us to grow excellent plants. And even further than that, in an urban environment, we simply don't have soil at all normally. So this means that people are able to grow excellent food, highly nutritious food, without relying on the soil that they're growing it in. I'm sure if you guys have our products, you're aware that they use a lot less space. So we can have them on our kitchen bench, which means that you're actually more likely to use your herbs. It's so easy if you're making a little bit of bolognese and you've got your basil growing right next to you. It's automatic to be putting it in. Sometimes we can forget if it's all the way in the backyard, or you often might not go down there at the nighttime to pick your basil. So it uses less space, which means we're able to keep it nice and convenient and close to us. And finally, it uses a lot less chemicals and pesticides. So like we mentioned before, we face a lot less issues with pests. And the soilless farming means that we don't have to add a lot of chemicals to it. So we don't have to fight against other weeds. So we're in a great spot here with hydroponics. And I hope that this is, if you're not converted already, this has made you super excited about the idea of hydroponics. And this is really just the tip of the iceberg of all the benefits that I see. Thank you guys for that. And now I'm going to pass back over to Dilhan, who's going to dive deep into what is hydroponics and all the best tips about how to use it. Thank you.
Thanks, Katlin. So I'll go into a bit of detail on hydroponics. I want to make this really focused about how you can actually understand the technical side better and use that to grow better in your own personal systems, whether you're growing indoor plants or plants for food. But before I dive into that a little bit more, let's play this video. Just give me 1 second to get it set up.
So, what is hydroponics? Growing plants in water without soil. Wait, back up. In nature, the soil a plant grows in serves two purposes. One, it anchors the plant from above ground hazards. Two, to provide the plant with nutrients it needs to keep growing. With hydroponics, these two purposes are handed off. The plant is supported by a net pot, which allows the roots to grow through into a nutrient-rich solution below. Hydroponics was first used as far back as 600 BC in the Hanging Gardens of Babylon, one of the seventh wonders of the world. By eliminating soil and housing the roots directly in water, the plants grown hydroponically flourished. This was achieved because plants grown hydroponically could absorb nutrients from water much more efficiently than plants grown in soil, resulting in faster growth and greater harvests.
Yeah, so I hope that helped to explain some of the fundamentals with hydroponics. It was quite a simple one and a little fun one with some nice music, as we always like. But yes, there's a lot more technical bits behind it, which I'll try to get into a bit more detail now. So to begin with, the big question of soil versus hydro, where does urban plant growers stand with this? To begin with, we have nothing against soil. If you can grow food with soil and hydro, do it. Grow as much food as you can, grow as many plants as you can, use every spare bit of land that you've got available to you to start growing your own food farm. We do believe, however, that within the current landscape with increasing urbanization, there is a necessity for people to grow more plants in their own home. And hydroponics is a perfect solution for that, for all of the reasons that Katie mentioned. So that includes obviously the fact that it uses way less space. It can grow without sunlight. It can use minimal water. So you can even leave some of our products for a couple of weeks and not have to worry about it. We really just want to fill those gaps that you may not be able to grow food with because of your lack of conditions. So moving into a bit more detail on how the different systems work, you've got soil-based systems. So in soil, you've got organic matter. This is leaves, sticks, animal droppings. It can be fruits, vegetables, anything that you use around the home. As this lands in the soil and it kind of enters the natural ecosystem, microbes break it down and turn it into minerals. These minerals are then absorbed by, or the water breaks them down and makes them soluble. And then they're absorbed by the plant roots, which then grow the plants. In comparison, hydroponics goes straight for the minerals. So we directly produce the minerals in a powder form or a liquid form. So when you add it to water, it automatically dissolves with a little bit of stirring, of course. The benefit of that is that the nutrients are readily available within the solution, meaning you can instantly get growing and your plants automatically have what they need to grow. So looking at some of the main characteristics of nutrients, altogether, there are 17 essential elements for plant growth. And I'll go into the broader categories over the next few slides. But, the ones that you can see in this slide are the macronutrients. So nitrogen, potassium, and phosphate. These are things that are required in large quantities to assist with plant growth. You will typically find these in soil fertilizers, but what soil fertilizers lack are micronutrients. So, skipped a slide ahead. So the micronutrients are calcium, magnesium, sulfur, boron, chlorine, iron, manganese, zinc, copper, molybdenum, and nickel. So if you were to buy sea salt or something from Bunnings and put it into water and then, hope that your plants grow, they might grow for a little bit, but without these essential micronutrients, they won't work. So if you do a quick count of this, you can see that there's 14 nutrients. And I'm sure some of you can, off the top of your heads, potentially think about what the other three could be. If not, it's about to be really obvious. Yep, that's right. Oxygen, hydrogen, and carbon. So the reason we kind of keep these separate are because you get oxygen, carbon, and hydrogen through water and air. These are obviously incredibly essential for plants, but you don't necessarily need to provide them within a hydroponic nutrient mix, obviously because they're readily available. Having said that, you still do need to consider them when you're choosing growth mediums, when you're choosing the kind of system that you want, or when you're choosing what plant you're growing. So for example, a lot of our products, they'll have water aeration pumps, obviously to assist in the aeration of the water so that more oxygen can get into the plant roots and up through the stems. Moving on from these, I wanted to talk about the way that we typically promote people to grow plants. So when we first started with Urban Plant Growers, we standardized everything. We figured out that we could use one standardized spoon, a nutrient spoon, with our powder and mix that in with 1 liter of water. And that would be enough to provide you with the nutrients that you need to grow your plants pretty well. We did that to make it simple and really easy and user-friendly for people to use. But you're all here because you want more details on hydroponics. So I'm going to go into exactly how you're meant to do it. So to begin with, I skipped a bit. The main measurement for the amount of nutrients in a hydroponic liquid is electrical conductivity. So this measures all the nutrients, they're essentially salts. So the more salt that is in a nutrient solution, the higher the electrical conductivity will be. So if you had pure water, distilled water from a tap, then distilled water from a distillery, you would have an electrical conductivity of zero. You might see this in a different range of measurements. So you would see EC, electrical conductivity, PPM, parts per million, TDS, total dissolved solids, and conductivity factor. They are all based off the electrical conductivity, which is in millisiemens. So I'm hoping I'm not losing anyone here, but you've got millisiemens, which is a direct read, and then you can convert that into parts per million by multiplying by 500 or 700. It depends on the meter that you're using. TDS is also multiplied by a factor, and then conductivity factor is millisiemens times 10. And the reason for that is because millisiemens are generally between 0.6 and like 6. So by multiplying by 10, you can put it into a more relatable number, you know, like 18 or 60 or something like that. Going into a bit more detail, you need to consider the fact that all of these nutrients dissolve at different pHs. So a lot of people would know if you've grown certain types of flowers or whatnot, that some plants grow in acidic conditions, whereas others grow better in alkaline conditions. The reason for that is that the minerals dissolve at different rates depending on the pH. So for most plants, you could get away with a 5.8 to 6.5 pH. And at that rate, you will have a lot of solubility for all of the various minerals and nutrients that you use in hydroponics. So you can see here, I've sort of outlined it in this graph with the red box. That's sort of your target region for most plants. Of course, if you have something specific that you want to grow, you can Google it and say, you know, what's the pH of basil that is ideal for growth, or what's the pH of a certain type of flower, and it'll tell you, and then you can probably try make your system meet that threshold. And then a final point is on the alkalinity. So pH is sort of an instantaneous reading of the acidity. Alkalinity is a different measure, which is the measure of calcium carbonates in water. And that is sort of a measure of the long-term stability of the solution to pH. So I'm hoping I'm not losing people too much here, but for most people, you may not need to go into the alkalinity of your hydroponic system, but it is just something to consider when you're looking at your water. So moving into some typical plants that everyone would grow, here are some ranges that you might need to consider. So for basil, you've got 5.5 to 6.5 pH and an electrical conductivity of 1 millisiemen to 1.6 millisiemens. As you can see, Herbs and leafy greens are fairly low. You can see lettuce down the bottom is 1.2 to 1.8 millisiemens. And, you know, you can compare that to a fruit plant like tomato, zucchini, or strawberries. And, you know, something like tomato goes all the way up to 5. Obviously, or maybe it's not obvious, but the later you get into plant growth, you may typically require a different type of nutrients. So fruiting plants, something like a tomato, at the start, it might need a lot of growth nutrients like nitrogen, but as it grows, the type of nutrients that it would need would change. You might need more potassium. And definitely when a plant is fruiting, so if you've got, you know, a lot of people here are mentioning tomatoes, if you've got tomatoes, you will reach a point where you need to feed them with a lot of potassium, and you can get nutrient blends for that that'll help that out during the plant growth time. Yes, and just a practical tip for a lot of you who are growing in some of our smart gardens. When you first plant your seeds, you won't need to add nutrients. You could probably leave it a week or two until the plants start to grow. They might grow to about that big, and then they'll grow their second set of leaves. At that point, they've probably expended all the energy within the seed itself, and that's when they need nutrients. So if you can add in nutrients after that point with a half dose, then you can minimize the amount of nutrients that you need. And I've also seen a couple of comments here about mold or algae. Regulating the nutrients will help with the algae for sure. So if you can kind of regulate that and keep it low and not overshoot how much nutrients you need to add, then you can get a lot more out of your system and you can use less nutrients in the process. So moving forward onto the growing mediums. The main characteristics you want to think about are the six that I've listed on the screen here. Water retention is quite obvious. You know, all plants need water. If they don't have this, they will die. Aeration, as I mentioned earlier, the oxygen from the plant roots is an essential element for plant growth. The way that this usually manifests itself within a growth medium is the surface of the growth medium. So you might get something that is very rough and porous and have a lot of tiny little holes on the surface. That is perfect for something that needs high aeration because there's all these tiny little air pockets for oxygen to go into and little air bubbles to go into. When the water solution goes up and down, it sort of reflushes out and adds in new stuff and the plant uses it as you go. That is perfect for something with good aeration. Another consideration might be reusability. So for example, some of you may have used clay balls before. Those are incredibly reusable. You don't have to do much. You can grow a whole cycle of plants and then at the end, kind of just spray them with some water and a lot of the roots will fall off. Obviously they're clay as well. So, you know, they're completely inert and they don't really break down or anything. Obviously another concern is sustainability. So, you need to think about this in a couple of ways. One is how can this thing be recycled? Can I reuse this? Is this a plastic? A lot of the growth mediums we use are not plastics. I'll go into them in a bit more detail. And then another point would be surface area. So this could be very useful for some people who are involved in aquaponics. The surface area of the growth medium can vary a lot. So if you've got something that's got a lot of tiny little air pockets, then that's perfect. It's got a huge amount of surface area. If you're growing things aquaponically, that provides a large surface area for microbial life to live on. And that microbial life is actually a good thing because it breaks down fish waste and turns it into plant food. So if you're interested in aquaponics, then the surface area of your growth medium is a huge consideration. And then, of course, the last point is the physical support. So the plants need to be held in a medium themselves. Obviously, soil is quite heavy and you can have huge plants in it. Some growth mediums may not be heavy enough to hold a huge plant if you're trying to grow something. So a couple of people have mentioned tomatoes. You would probably need a fairly big rock wool cube or maybe a big basin of vermiculite or perlite to get that going correctly. And then I've just made quite a simple chart to show how some of the typical growth mediums that we offer rank in terms of water absorption and oxygenation. The main reason I've used these two factors rather than the other six that were there is because typically when you're choosing a plant, these are the two main factors that will affect its growth. Sustainability and reusability are essential, but the first thing you need to know is which one of these is potentially the best option for you. So on the right-hand side, we've got rock wool and perlite. These are really high aeration because they've got hundreds of little air pockets inside them, thousands of little air pockets. When you soak it with water, there are still heaps of little bits of air within that, which the plant roots can reach out towards and then suck all that up and use it for plant growth. Rock wool is basically a glass. It's like obsidian, which has been heated to a really high temperature and then spun around like fairy floss. And the result of that is you get this really light substance, which is, it's just like fairy floss, but harder, of course. And that is a really good way to start your seeds or, even once they've grown past the seeds, maintain it in that, but put it in the net cup and keep it growing. Similarly, we've got perlite there, which is incredible for aeration. If you know how to use it, it can be a really great asset. On the top left, we have vermiculite, or smart soil as we refer to it, and it's what we have in our smart garden. So that one's got incredible water absorption capabilities. It absorbs 4 to 7 times its own weight in water. And if you use it in like a wicking system or something like that where it uses capillary action, then it can actually pull up water from a basin below it and keep the plants just as moist as they need to be. beautiful comment on the alarm there. And then on the bottom left, we've got expanded clay balls. So these are lightweight expanded clay aggregate, sometimes referred to as LECA, L-E-C-A. And they're really popular with indoor plant growers because they're just so easy and versatile. You can put them in a bucket of any pot really, and then just fill it with a decent amount of water and then put your propagated plant in and you'll have pretty good success growing. And then just kind of outlining a summary of how I see these things. Rock wool on the top right is perfect for seeds. Vermiculite or smart soil on the top left is perfect for seeds as well. On the bottom right, we've got perlite, which is incredible but hard to learn because if you mess it up, it doesn't hold on to much water in itself. So if the plant gets dry too quickly, it can die pretty quickly. Similar thing for the expanded clay. Some other notable mentions include coconut coir, coconut mats, and sponges. So the coconut options are incredible because they're so environmentally friendly. You know, they're obviously a biodegradable product. They're quite simple to use. And it's a bit more intuitive to some people because it feels a bit more like soil. Sponge can be really difficult because it's harder to guarantee the germination of a seed. But they're good if you know exactly how to use it because you can reuse them quite well. And I'm just conscious of time, so I will crack on a little bit. So moving on to grow lights. The main thing that plants need from the sun to grow is light, but specifically blue and red light. That's because the blue light helps with the formation of chlorophyll and the red light promotes germination, root growth, and bulb development. So, you can see our grow lights here, our Breezy Grow LED light. That one is primarily, actually, it's basically just the blue and the red. And a lot of people will tell you just how well it works with growing their plants. There are some plants that may need other wavelengths. And we have those available too in some of our full spectrum grow lights. Just before I move on to the next slide, I will do a bit of a recap on some of the other options of grow lights in sort of the hydroponics field. There are fluorescent options, which are like fluorescent tubes. There are metal halides, high intensity discharge, plasma lights, and then of course LEDs. In my opinion, all of the other lights use a ridiculous amount of energy and don't make sense for everyday people. They only make sense if you're a real hardcore hobbyist or perhaps if you're in a commercial farm. But for the 99% of people, I think LEDs are the best option. They release the least heat. They last you know, up to over 5,000 hours in some cases. They are easy to use, and obviously they're quite user friendly. So they're definitely my winner. And then, yeah, moving on to this one, you can see in our eco kitchen, we've got a mixture between, I think this is actually our family farm. We've got a mixture between both white light and red light. So I want to note that while that white light might look white, it's actually a combination of a couple of different spectrums put together. So you've got the blue, the green, the yellow, and then of course the red. And that whole combination, that whole profile is what helps your plants grow. Not all plants would need this whole spectrum, but some do. While I'm on the topic of grow lights, I will discuss some of the measurements for it, because there is typically quite a lot of confusion. So a lot of people will ask us, what's the wattage of the lights? The wattage doesn't generally infer exactly how the plants will grow. Similarly, we might be asked what the lux or the lumens of the light bulbs are. The lux and the lumens are a measure of light within the visible eye spectrum. So light that humans can see. But for plants, that's not necessarily relevant. So while those are good for lighting your home, it's not the best measure of how efficient a grow light is. We've got what is more important is the PAR, so the photosynthetic active radiation. That shows the proportion of light provided by the grow light, which is within the range used by plants. Within that PAR ratio, there's PPFD, which is photosynthetic flux density, photon photosynthetic flux density, and that is just the intensity of light within that area. So hoping I'm not losing too many people here, I'm hoping people are getting value out of this. You might not need to know this at the moment, but it will help if you decide to, you know, take your hydroponic skills to the next level. And then, yeah, of course, efficiency, micromoles per joules, which of course you probably wouldn't need to know in too much detail either. Going into some environmental factors, with your humidity, the vast majority of plants like 40 to 60% humidity. You might have some tropical plants who need a lot more, but I think you could solve the needs of most of your plants just by maintaining this. I would say if you're growing your plants indoors, most houses would be around this level, if not just a little bit below. Temperature, aim between 20 and 30 degrees. This is, yet again, quite easy to achieve in an indoor condition, because your house will naturally like fluctuate towards that temperature. If you're germinating seeds, especially tropical stuff, something like basil, it might be good to put them in a warmer place. So maybe if you've got a room that's closer to a window, or a room that is against a wall that always gets hot, or, you know, something like that, then that would be a better place to put those seedlings until they grow. And then of course, airflow. So airflow is quite essential. One, it pulls away water from the leaves. And by pulling away water from the leaves, it actually kind of sucks up water from the plant roots, which is essential to like flushing the system of the plant. If you were to have water stagnate in the cells of the plant, then the plant would get moldy and die. So you actually, like, airflow is quite essential. And if you can put your product in a place that has a bit of natural airflow next to a window or something like that, then that would generally assist with the plant growth. And it would probably also reduce some of the mold or algae problems that you could have. I think so. So that's definitely something that you should try to do if possible. And then of course, water temperature. So this also isn't too much of an issue unless you're growing with one of our kits in outdoor conditions. So maybe a hydro pot where your unit would be getting blasted by sun all day. But you need to keep your water in the low 20s. The reason for this is if they get too hot, the plants can develop root rot, which is where the roots start going brown, they start dying. It's actually a microbe which attacks the plant. And once you've got that, it's really hard to reverse it. So in that picture with me there on the right, you can see how white and clean the plant roots are. That's because that unit was in stable conditions. It had lots of oxygenation in the water, good circulation, and it was kept cool. You might see your plants start to get a bit darker. That is not a good condition. You need to keep the temperature of your water lower. And to kind of start wrapping things up, I'll try to do some quick practical takeaways for your smart garden. So on humidity, if you've got high humidity, so very wet air, then your plant won't be releasing much water into the atmosphere. So as a result, it'll use a lot of nutrients, which will end up with, it won't use much water, but it will use nutrients. So you'll end up with a high nutrient concentration. Low nutrient concentration. If you were to have a low humidity scene, so dry air, you'd end up consuming a lot of water. The plant would obviously reject that into the atmosphere. And as a result, you'd get high nutrient concentration within the basin. So the reason why this is good or bad is if you go too high, you can experience leaf burn, which is where your leaves start going crispy, they go brown, they don't look very healthy. That's just because you're providing them with too much nutrients. And on the other hand, you can have osmosis. You can experience osmosis. So if the water is too salty, then the nutrient, the plant will actually try to give some of its water to the salty nutrient solution to try and reduce the salinity of the water. And if your plant is giving water to the nutrients, then it'll run out of water and it'll die, which is obviously a horrible way for a plant to die. So that's why you would avoid high nutrient concentration. And then similarly, with a low nutrient concentration, you'll just get stunted growth. Finally, the last takeaway I would say would be, if things are going badly wrong, just throw the water out and start again with a new nutrient solution. I've also already mentioned this point on, planting the seeds. So you don't necessarily need to add algae immediately. A final point would be just wash your smart garden out at the end of each grow cycle before you're ready to get a new batch in. This will help keep your units clean, and it'll also make it a lot easier next time you put some new seeds in. So that marks the end of my section. So we will take some questions and answers. I'll just bring Katlin back up and then maybe we'll try select a couple that are good to answer. I'll also try catch up on some of these previous questions on the chat.
Great, thanks so much for that, Dilhan. We have some pretty excited people in that chat. Everyone's stoked with the information that you shared with us and your knowledge. It is incredible. He's spent a lot of time and hours learning about hydroponics. So thank you so much for that, Dilhan. We've had a lot of questions. Jackie and I have been very busy trying to answer as many of those questions as we could while Dilhan was talking. In just being conscious of time, Dilhan, I'm going to send two main questions over to you to start with. The first one that we're getting a lot from people is about mold, and the other one is about aphids or other pests. So if you could cover those first.
Yeah, sure. So on the point of mold, I'm not 100% sure if it's mold or algae, but I'll just try address both of them. So if you've got algae, which is obviously like a green growth, your growth medium, that is a result of the nitrogen being eaten by a naturally occurring bacteria, which is algae. The way that you avoid it is you can maintain a low nutrient concentration and prevent the light from hitting the algae, or you could try to prevent the growth medium from touching too much of the nutrients at surface level altogether. If you grow with something like clay balls, you won't really have that problem. Other ways would be a UV light that can sterilize it, but that's probably not something that would happen within one of our grow lights. Moving on to the mold issue, mold is a couple of factors put together. So one, it's low airflow. So when you have stale, damp conditions, you typically will get some mold. And the other one would be lack of UV light. So with our hydroponic lights, we always get the question of, are they UV lights? Are they damaging? Is that how they work? They're not actually UV lights. UV lights is damaging to plants in the same way that it's damaging to people. But the good thing about UV rays is it kills stuff like mold. And obviously because we're not providing any UV light, we're not killing some of that mold, so that can be a problem. I'd say the best way to combat it is, try stick it in a place with decent airflow. If you do have any way of getting UV light, even chuck it out outside for like a day or two if you have any sunlight available to kill the mold, then that would be a good way to get rid of it. If it's there and it's stuck, you could use a diluted solution of hydrogen peroxide, which is available at most like pharmacies and stuff like that. You could use a dilute solution of that and just spray it on the base of the growth medium, and that should kill it all and hopefully won't come back. Another point to add is the algae and the mold aren't inherently bad for the plant growth. Algae does take up nutrients, which is a bad thing, and it can make the stem of the plant wet, which can cause it to rot. But the actual growth of the plant would be okay. And it's a similar thing for the mold. I hope that answers that question.
Thanks, Dilhan. And then if you could just touch on pests, specifically aphids is one that had raised a lot.
Yeah, sure. So aphids are incredibly tough. You can have a couple of aphids enter your system and it'll be pretty difficult to get rid of. Natural solutions would be, like, in nature, ladybugs eat pests, but obviously in your home that's not really a possibility. So what you could do is you could have a soapy water solution, obviously not too concentrated, and then just dunk the stems of your plants in that. And try to rinse off or brush off all of the aphids until they're gone. The life cycle of aphids is quite short. So if you do this maybe every 3 days and do it two or three times, that should get rid of them completely. It is a difficult one once you get aphids, just because they're very hard to get rid of in any condition, really. I look at some of the larger hydroponic systems going on commercially, and it's just terrifying. Like, if you see pictures of hydroponic farms 20, 30 stories high that are just packed with like lettuce, and if you just get one aphid, it can ruin your crop. So yeah, I guess if worst comes to worst and you do have aphids and the washing it off doesn't work, then I would completely seize everything, leave it for a week until all the aphids die off or leave, and then try start again. If nothing else works. In terms of prevention, you can use like a neem oil or a white oil and spray that on your plants, but you just need to make sure that if you're eating the leaves, you give it a wash before you do eat it. Like Caitlin said before, like, hydroponics doesn't really use pesticides or anything because you're indoors, but if you do end up having a problem like that, then there are some fairly organic solutions to prevent against that.
Excellent. Thank you, Dilhan. I'm going to take a question just to give you a moment to go through the question list and see if there's anything jumping out at you that you want to answer before we wrap up for tonight. Keep in mind, guys, that we will keep this sidebar open, so we'll try and answer those questions before we close off tonight. And there will be more webinars in the future, so this isn't the last one. It's not your last opportunity to engage with us. It's just a taster. And like I mentioned, that community Facebook page is a great way to keep asking your questions and follow threads through there. Put in any ideas, photos, anything like that. I'd love to see your engagement there. Just as great as we've had the engagement tonight. So one question I've had a lot of is just what else you can grow. We do a lot of herbs is a big one that's shown in a lot of our photos. But yeah, you can grow a lot of different things in our systems, from your leafy greens, small fruits and vegetables. Tomatoes are a big one, as we mentioned, strawberries. Basically, what I would say is be creative with it. It's just like growing in your garden, slightly different because you're indoors and it's a bit more of a smaller space. So you're not going to be growing a banana tree in your system, but you are able to grow a lot of different things. So get creative. Don't feel like you're restricted to what you can grow. But the best things to grow are your herbs and leafy greens, because they're fast growing and they don't take up too much space. And we use them a lot, which is great. One thing I do want to flag is to stay tuned on the Urban Plant Growers space, because we do have a product coming soon where we're going to be engaging with you guys more about more seeds to grow, so you can learn different things to grow in your systems. And have the opportunity to be involved with a few more seeds. So if you stay tuned this space, we'll be sending out emails in the future to our customers about how they can get engaged with different seeds that we have available. And just before I hand back to Dilhan, if he has any other questions he wants to answer, we will be having another final poll, just going back to that right-hand side. Just if you can tell us, give us some feedback about tonight's webinar would be really handy. So back to you now, Dilhan.
Thanks, Katlin. Looking at all of these, I see there's a big need for a product which can grow tomatoes. The issue from urban plant growers' point of view is that we're struggling to make it into a beautiful product. You know, we want things that look good in your home and look like it fits in there. I would suggest the best thing that you could get that's one of our products would potentially be a hydropot. Otherwise, I would look into a DIY solution. If you research Dutch bucket, it's a form of hydroponics that is used in commercial farms all around the world to grow tomatoes. So Dutch bucket for tomatoes, you can just get a bucket from Bunnings maybe, and then some PVC pipes, and you could potentially DIY one yourself. And then we'd love to hear about how it works if you do. So please send us the pictures and the feedback. Doing a couple of other questions, there's one on expanded clay and using wicking thread. Typically we do not, because the expanded clay wouldn't really hold on to any of that. So you'd only have water at the thread itself, and it depends on what kind of plant roots you've got. Taking a few others that are not answered so far. So airflow. Yeah, I think the air condition inside an office setting would be sufficient airflow for a hydroponic unit. It's not natural, but there is a certain level of CO2 and temperature that is required by airflow in offices. So I think that would be completely fine. In terms of the cigarette foams in the dishwasher, they're just regular, I wouldn't call them cigarette foams, they're sort of just sponge from the indoor smart garden. I know the question you're asking. You probably could. I would recommend seeing if you can get like a cloth wick and use that instead. And a couple of questions that have all seemed to be answered. Alexandra asked a question on if vermiculite and rock wool are good for seeds. Can you keep your plants in either of those materials, or do you need to transplant it into something else? Yes, you can keep those in both of those materials. So you can grow it all the way from seedling to a large plant. In terms of the grow lights, Jonas Kolb, is it okay to have automatic lights on at night and still have ambient room lights during the day? Yes, that's fine. Although I would try to sync up the outside light with the grow light itself. The main reason for that is just plants have a respiratory cycle just like we do. They need to breathe in during the day and then out at night. And the light syncing with that helps them have that cycle. Another one on mold. And yeah, I think I've answered most of the questions in the questions section. If not, please do reach out. Do reach out to our customer service or any of the areas that I know Katlin will point out now. I'll just pass back to Katlin.
Thank you so much, Dilhan. That was very valuable. I know I even had some things there. So thank you for sharing your knowledge with us. Just to wrap up, again, if you could go answer that last poll, would be fantastic. And I think really the best way for us to all stay connected beyond this before our next webinar would be to go into that Facebook community page. So that QR code's up there on the screen again, if you'd like to use it. Otherwise, just jump on to Facebook. It was also in our most recent newsletter. If you've signed up to our newsletter, we have a link in there for that as well. So please stay engaged. Keep asking these great questions, because it's really important that we know what issues you're having with our products, or if you have any recommendations, so we can help support you guys to keep on growing. Thank you all very much for joining tonight. It was really great. I'm so glad that we've done this together, and I look forward to hearing more questions and sharing more webinars in the future. So thank you, everyone, very much.
Thanks, everyone.